Hello, welcome to our service of Holy Communion from St James's Church here in Rowledge. Following our time of national mourning, we continue to remember Her Majesty the Queen and the royal family and all those who mourn the death of a loved one. But we also remember that we are in a season of Easter where we reflect on Jesus having overcome death and having overcome the grave. And so we can proclaim, Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. And so we're going to sing our first hymn today. We say together a prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And we bring before the Lord those things that we wish to offer to him in a prayer of confession. God of resurrection, of life and death and rebirth, renew our hearts and minds. God of promise, of all beginnings and all endings, renew our hearts and minds. God of hope, of new growth and of harvest, renew our hearts and minds. And may the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen. And this collect for our Easter season. God of glory, by the raising of your Son, you have broken the chains of suffering and of death. Fill your church with faith and hope, for a new day has dawned, and the way to life stands open to us in our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. We proclaim the words of the Gloria together. We turn to our Bible reading. Alleluia, alleluia. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Alleluia. Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Glory to you, O Lord.
On the third day, a wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, "They have no more wine." "Woman, why do you involve me?" Jesus replied. "My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby stood six stone water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 80 to 120 litres. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now, draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet." They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, "Everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now." What Jesus did here in Cana of Galilee was the first of the signs through which he revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him.
Good morning. This begins a series of reflections on the subject of the generosity of God. When I was doing some preaching in the United States of America a few years ago, my visit to Philadelphia coincided with the visit of Pope Francis to the same city. Of course, our visits there were not connected whatsoever. But there was a lot of press coverage about the Pope's first visit to the United States. It was on all the television. And I remember watching a live broadcast of his approach as he came into Philadelphia that day. The first surprise was that the Pope's motorcade was not some great big limousine of a car. He was actually sitting in the back of a Toyota, and rather crunched up, I thought, in the back of this Toyota. And along it came, not too fast, with the Holy Father waving, as it were, from the side window. And just as it went past the camera, the brakes suddenly went on. And you saw Pope Francis scramble out the back of this Toyota and came running back up the road because it was lined with an enormous number of spectators. He came running back and went straight to a family group who had a child in a wheelchair, and he knelt down and words were exchanged with the child. There was a smile and a concerned look on the Pope's face. He laid his hands upon the child, obviously doing a prayer of blessing, and cupped his face in his hands, shook hands with the parents, presumably his mum and dad, and they went running back like a late schoolboy when the bell was going, jumped back in the Toyota and drove away. That moment has never left me. I thought, what a remarkable man. This was an unplanned stop. He was on his way to a particular meeting, and he tells his driver to stop. And he goes because he'd seen this child as he passed by, and it triggered something inside of him. And so he comes to show his care. This was generosity, I think, almost above and beyond the call of duty. And it was a moment that I think struck many hearts of the power of the compassion in this particular pontiff. What is generosity then? I looked up a dictionary definition, and here's one for you. It's to give or act in ways that go beyond the level of what was expected of us. There's a surprise element to the whole idea of being generous. There's a more than element in it. There's an abundance moment in generosity, and it conveys such warmth and positive regard for the other person. Well, in our gospel reading today, the wedding in Cana of Galilee, we see two examples of this generosity I'd like to explore with you. There's the generosity of Mary, the mother of Jesus, and there's the generosity of Jesus himself. I want to include Mary and her generosity along with Jesus and his generosity, because I think one inspires and derives almost from the other, or there's a deep mutuality. I do find that when I'm around generous people, I get more generous. I get more risky and more beneficial, hopefully, in my life. It's good to be around generous people, not for what you can get from them, but what you can learn from them. Let's look at Mary, shall we? Few things I'd like to say. First of all, at the wedding, she saw a need. They'd run out of wine, quite a disastrous thing in a wedding party. And she cared enough to want to do something about it. She didn't have to. She was a guest. And like every other guest, was expected to bring some wine to the celebration of presumably a family wedding that was fully underway. Some commentators say no wonder they ran out of wine, because Jesus was invited and he brought along his disciples. They were invited too. We're not told how many, but I think it was more than the wedding party expected, possibly. And so they run out of wine, which would be a major embarrassment to the parents of the bridegroom in particular. And Mary could have gossiped. She could have talked to people and said, They didn't plan this properly, did they? And do all that kind of critiquing that we are oh so familiar with when we get things wrong. Not Mary. She cares enough to want to do something about it. And she cared enough, secondly, to bother her son and said, they've run out of wine. She didn't actually say, can you fix it? But I think it's implied. They've run out of wine. And she was not put off by his response. Some people think his response is rather hard. I mean, the Greek word here is gunai, woman. What have I got to do with you? Or to give it its exact reference, because this is a well-known phrase. And it literally means this, and you'll find this in the Passion Translation in particular, where Jesus says to Mary, woman, what is that for you and me? What do we have to share about this particular issue you have raised? The Passion Translation puts it this way. If I do this, if I respond to this need you've made me aware of, it won't change anything for you, but it will change everything for me. Now, there's a costliness that Jesus is referring to. What could that costliness be? He does say, my hour has not yet come. Did Mary know instantly what that meant? Do we? Because this is one of those exclamations that Jesus utters quite a few times in his 3 years of ministry. My hour has not yet come. His hour had not yet come. His destiny with Calvary had not yet come. Did she know the significance of this? That in a way, in responding to his mother, it's launching his public ministry. Did she know this, I wonder? Did she know him enough? Did she who said, be it according to your word in my life, she who knows what it is to surrender to the words of God, had she got to the point now where she appreciated Jesus' destiny? He had disciples now. He was about to begin a ministry. Was it Mary who thought, what a better place than to do it right here and launch it in the context of celebrating lives coming together? What better thing to celebrate than lives coming together with God? And so I think she pushed it a bit. What mothers don't push it a bit with their children? But she cares enough to risk it. And she knows her boy. She knows her son. And even though he has this, it's a big thing for me. This is starting something new. Does she say, oh, okay then, have it your way? She turns to the servant and says, whatever he tells you, do it. She knows something is coming. It's like she's been the go-between to open the door of access of God to us and others to God. All Christians are called upon to be like this, that God uses us as a doorway of introduction to help people come to know the Lord Jesus for themselves. I think I just want to encourage us to learn from Mary's generosity. Being generous is no pushover. It's not easy, and there are risks that come. But at the heart of all generosity, as far as looking at Mary is concerned, is I care enough to risk this. I care enough to want to do something about it. In Songs of Praise, a Sunday or two ago, they were actually interviewing the top research scientist professor behind the formulation of the Oxford AstraZeneca vaccine. And he said a remarkable thing almost in passing. I don't know if you saw it, where he was being interviewed. And he said, one of the things we stipulated at the very beginning of doing this research is that we want it to be given free. There is a cost to producing anything, I know this, but we don't want to charge people above that. It's, if you like, cost price. It's free. And he said, I wanted to do this as an act of faith. He cared enough. He could have made so much money from this, but he chose not to. And for me, I thought, what a bombshell of generosity. That man and his team, and the powers that be in the Oxford University stroke business world, were like, to make such an impact upon our society in this great time of need, and to do it generously in that way. I remember I was preaching at the Church of the Word, and the vicar was then the Reverend Alison Barfoot, who went on to become the Bishop of Ballarat eventually. And her church congregation met in a Roman Catholic school in Virginia, but not far from Washington, D.C. And as I was going along giving out communion alongside of Alison, I came to this man, and for some reason I felt stirred in my spirit. And as I was offering him the bread, I just had this inner nudge I should say something to him. And so without making a meal of it, as I said, the body of Christ keep you in eternal life, I also said to him, and just one other thing, finish what you started. And then I moved on. A year later, when I was back in the United States and I met Alison at a healing conference I was taking part in, she came up to me and told me what happened next. She said, do you remember giving Holy Communion to a gentleman and saying to him, finish what you started? Did you know him? And I said, no, of course not. And I did have this nudge. I hope he wasn't offended by what I said. And she said, he came to see me. He was really upset by what you said. The reason he was upset was he had been in the Vietnam War and, like many a soldier, was terribly frightened of dying. And he had a kind of faith, and he made it a prayer to God that, God, if you get me out of this, if I come through this in one piece, I will give you all that I am. And he had done nothing about it. And 30 years had rolled by, and you said, finish what you started. It troubled him because he had not finished what he started. He owned an allotment, quite a large one actually, doing fruit and vegetables, and was doing quite well. And he was approached by the Disney Corporation and offered millions of dollars to sell his farmland so they could build a Disney complex on the east coast of America on his land. And he thought, millions of dollars, but I haven't finished what I started. And after some prayer, he phoned Alison, hence my knowing this conversation, and informed her that he wished to give his virtually all his land to the church so they can have a proper place to build a brand new church for this new faith community. Isn't that amazing? Generosity of heart. Now, I'm not telling you how to go about being generous. I wouldn't have the nerve. But I think we can learn something from Mary. I think we can ask God to stir us by his Spirit, to at least care enough to see what needs there are, and care enough to take it to Jesus and say, whatever you say, let's do it, Lord, and see what happens next. Let's learn to be a generous people. And secondly, Jesus also shows his generosity, not just in the amount of wine. Everyone wants to tell you that there's six jars of water there, and together they would be 120 gallons, and all of them he made into new wine. And it was taste and see by the wine tasters, who said, this is totally different. Wow, this is generous. This is not the usual way of proceeding. Normally, we keep the best wine at the beginning and then we tail off and give them the ordinary stuff. But you've role reversed everything. Your generosity goes all the way through the wedding celebration. And Jesus is doing this because, I think, for two things. He wants to show why and where his generous heart goes. And it comes in two forms, if you like, in the wine, or the new wine, if you like, and it being referred to as the first sign, revealing his glory, by which his disciples put their trust in him. Isn't that fascinating? They were his disciples, they were following him, but they had not yet put their trust in him. How true is that so many times of us? We can be followers and come to church and be totally authentic in all of that, but have we put our trust in him in a personal way for our lives? Two ways that Jesus was generous. The first one was with wine. And if you look at what scripture has to teach us about wine, then it's a prophetic vehicle. Marriage and wine actually is one of the imageries in the Old Testament of God's way of saying, when I come back to fulfill my promises of calling you to flourish, it will be like a wedding feast where the wine flows freely. This God is no teetotaler. Due respects to those who are, but this is a God of sheer celebration. So weddings and wine are a prophetic symbol of God lavishing his love upon us. We're told that new wine goes into new wineskins. In other words, new wine doesn't come to prop up what was once, but actually to resource the new that is now. New promises. It's no strange thing, I think, in our Anglican and Roman Catholic liturgies that we continually use the phrase to walk in newness of life. It's the new wine life. The new wine is also a symbol of the Holy Spirit. These men aren't drunk with wine. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, they're drunk on the Holy Spirit, if you want to follow that through. And so wine is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And so you could say, God wants us to be so filled with the Holy Spirit, it extends to 120 gallons worth. Not just eking out bits of Holy Spirit encounter, but an outpouring of the Holy Spirit, a Pentecostal streaming of the Holy Spirit. New wine is a prophetic picture of God celebrating love over us. It's a picture of the outpouring of the Holy Spirit upon us. And thirdly, wine and new wine is a symbol of the costly blood sacrifice of Jesus made upon the cross within days before his execution at Calvary. He takes the bread and comes to the wine and says, "This is my blood, the new covenant, which is shed for many." So new wine also represents the sacrificial heart of God, that he will go out of his way, generously, miles and miles out of his way to the cross of Calvary in order to give us chance and opportunity to walk in that newness of life through this new wine love of God. Secondly, the scripture tells us about this event of Jesus, that this was the first sign to begin his ministry. And that word sign is semeion in Greek. You could say it means signpost. It points to the significance of the one who stands amongst us. Let me just very quickly, as I bring this sermon to a close, run through those other signs. There's the sign of the new wine, and we've explored what that says. There's the sign of the healing of the rich man's son, that the healing power of God is available to restore us to wholeness of living. And that's in John chapter 4, starts in verse 46, interestingly enough, in the same town of Cana of Galilee. The third sign is the blind boy mentioned in John chapter 9, where Jesus heals the one born blind. This has never been done in recorded history before. That's why the kid gets interrogated so closely by the Pharisees, because the generosity of Jesus had excelled. He'd gone beyond all ways of caring. He had done the impossible. He had given sight to someone who never had it before. It was an astounding miracle. And fourthly, out of this quartet of signs, is the raising of Lazarus in John 11, the sign of resurrection, life and power. a sign, if you like, that the experiences of this life are not the only life. There is an eternal life that God wants us to live. His generosity doesn't extend to our present circumstances. It extends to the possibility of eternity. This is the generosity that we glimpse in Jesus Christ that day when he began his public ministry. May God so move us by his Holy Spirit that not only do we make the most of his generosity, but we go and do likewise. Amen.
As we proclaim our faith together, you might like to stand in your own home and say these words with me. Let us affirm our faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Though he was divine, he did not cling to equality with God, but made himself nothing. Taking the form of a slave, he was born in human likeness. He humbled himself and was obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God has raised him on high and given him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every voice proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Jenny's going to lead us in our intercessions today.
Let us pray. God of all our prayers, we come to you today with our whole selves, God of our honest prayers and sometimes more honest silences when we don't have the words. Open our eyes to see and our ears to hear and our hearts to understand how you are already here with us. Mother God, gather us as a hen gathers her chicks, and let us catch our breath for 1 second and remember how you hold the whole world in your kind, capable, wise hands, including us. Spirit, when we cannot part the weeds of our own traditions, the old languages, when the old pathways of prayer feel choked with briars and thorns, would you make a path in the wilderness for us to find you in new ways and new words, new practices, new permissions? Would you meet us in the wilderness and set out a feast? We are hungry and thirsty. We give thanks for the life of His Royal Highness, the Prince Philip, and we continue to pray for the Queen and Royal Family, asking for peace and your comfort. We thank you for the life of Cynthia Samuel, whose funeral was this week, and we ask for her family and all who mourn her loss to be comforted. We pray for Layla and Martin as they continue to look for a house and ask for your divine provision for them, that they might know you are with them and you are supporting them and helping them. And we pray for Ian and Patricia as they are dealing with sickness, and we pray for their family. We are grateful for every moment that brought us here to you, and for the moments that we're not so grateful, help us to look back and be able to see that no matter what, you have been with us, holding us. Help us to sink down into your love, to push our roots down into that marvelous love, and be planted within your power and grace as we practice loving this world as you have loved this world. May we laugh harder because we have learned to let ourselves weep with you. May we see and know and name beauty because we have learned to bring the ugliness to you. Surprise us and startle us. We're open to all the different ways you want to speak in us, to us, and through us. May we be peacemakers, joy bringers, truth tellers, status quo disruptors, wanderers, wonderers, and misfits to our time, who never settle for the sit down and be quiet life, but rise up in your who the sun sets free is free indeed, birthright of freedom. May we be the ones who come close to you because of our vulnerability and not because of our false certainties. Teach us to lay down our masks and pretenses. You tore down the veil between us and the Holy of Holies. Keep our hands from rehanging that curtain. Give us opportunities to practice mercy and courage. Call us to humility, confession, and repentance, even when pride feels more comfortable and superior. Teach us how to rest, how to abide, and how to light candles and be satisfied. Don't let us get away with separating our prayers from our politics and policies and practices. May we love our neighbors. May we include you in every aspect of our life. May we learn to sit with you in silence and know it is enough to know you and be known by you and know ourselves. Teach us to pray, God, as you always have welcomed us to pray, fully human, fully yours, fully held, and fully loved. We will tell you the truth of our lives and of this world, and we will listen to the truth you speak back to us, the truth of our belovedness, of your justice, of your faithfulness, of love, and say, let it be so, let it be in me. Amen.
The risen Christ came and stood amongst his disciples and said, peace be with you. Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. The peace of the risen Christ be always with you and also with you. As we prepare to receive Holy Communion, you might like to make sure that you have some bread and some wine available to you. And as we do, we sing our next hymn. As we reflect on the generosity of God, we remember yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the victory and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you and of your own do we give you. Amen. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give thanks and praise. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in the great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh As your son, he was born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms of love on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying together, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death. Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup. And we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and to serve you. Send your Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share in this bread and this one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you for ever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. And so, rejoicing in God's new creation, let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. Lord, our hearts are hungry for you. Give us this bread always. And so we draw near with faith to receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for us, his blood, which was shed for us. We eat and drink in remembrance that he died for each of us, and we feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. having received the bread and the wine in our own homes, wherever we are, we pray together the prayer after communion. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. And so we're going to sing our closing hymn together. As we come to the end of our service in this Easter season, a prayer of blessing. All our problems we send to the cross. All our difficulties we send to the cross. All the devil's works we send to the cross. And all our hopes we set on the risen Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and with those whom you love, now and forever. Amen. He is not here, he is risen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. In the name of Christ, amen. Alleluia, alleluia.